Anybody in a Christmas spirit? Thank you, baby. He's like, woo. Really? Can I tell you, I love Christmas. Like, I am the one whose tree is up before Thanksgiving, although we broke all tradition this year. We was late on everything. I love the season. It is just everything about it. And you get into it with people, it's a pagan holiday, and blah, 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 blah. I don't want to hear none of that. What I want you to know is that I'm celebrating my Savior's birth. It ain't about Frosty or Rudolph or Santa or none of his friends. It is about the celebration of the Savior. And it's amazing that we get the chance to celebrate the Savior, and everybody else is fooled thinking they celebrating something else, but they celebrate the Savior too. You can call him Santa Claus, you can call him Mr. Jingle, you can call him whatever you want to call him. But in essence, we are celebrating the Savior. And so Christmas has always been my favorite time of the year. And as Christmas passed, if I would look back, I was a spoiled child. My parents made sure that Christmas was special. And we had more than we would ever need and more than we could ever open on Christmas morning. One time, literally, I came and seen the tree and I passed out. It was like Toys R Us. Everything that I wanted was there, and I literally passed out. I'm telling you, Christmas was a big thing. And I think it was a big thing because my mother and father struggled with Christmas. And so they wanted to make sure that we had the Christmases that they never had. Anybody can kind of agree with that? And so I reaped all the benefits of their struggle. But it's something about Christmas. You know, we have Christmas traditions, and we would go. I said I wasn't gonna talk about this. We would go to Baker Square. Anybody remember Baker Square? I'm aging myself right here. My young people's like, what? Baker Square. And see, I used to like to go to Baker Square because you could get dessert and you can get a piece of pie with your meal. And at Christmas time, they used to sell candy cane pie. And it wasn't Christmas until I got a piece of candy. I used to get a chicken breast focaccia sandwich with french fries and honey mustard. I've been doing this since I was 7 years old. And a piece of candy cane pie. And if y'all was here last year, y'all know what happened to my candy cane pie. They discontinued it. I'm 40 plus years old, and you gonna stop making Christmas candy cane pie this year? In the middle of a pandemic? Like, the least you could have did is held it another couple years till we get through this. Christmas is everything. But out of all the great Christmases I had, one of my favorite Christmases was the first year my husband and I had gotten married. And we was broker than broke. I mean broke, broke. So we had a tree, but we didn't have no decorations. And I used to do hair. So my sister went and got all of my hair supplies and decorated the tree. So the tree had rollers and the wraps around your head. That was the garland. It was, you know, the wrap. And sponges and all this. She redecorated this whole tree. And I just was looking at the tree like, that tree is pitiful. It looked worse than Charlie Brown's tree. And so we were determined we were going to celebrate Christmas. And so we invited a few friends over. And I told you, teacher, we was broke, broke. So there was no feast. We had seasoned minute rice, spaghetti, Mia, spaghetti, and some hot dogs and beans. Don't be laughing at my struggle. And laid it out. And my friends came, the few that we still had. Man, we had the best time of our life. It wasn't a gift nowhere. It was the fact of celebrating and being together. And we laughed at that tree. And we ate them beans and spaghetti all that next week. But it was the joy of celebrating the risen King. It wasn't about the presents. And I realized then that the reason that I really loved Christmas, it wasn't about the gifts. It was about the joy that God loved us enough to send us a gift in Jesus Christ. And so we're on our series of Advent, and we have talked about this last week, that Advent means coming. They were waiting for the baby to come. We are preparing. All the hustle and bustle and buying gifts and everything that's going on is the waiting, the expectation of the Messiah. Well, now we're in the second form of the waiting. We're waiting for the second coming, where we should be just as much hustle and bustle preparing for when he comes. But in this season of waiting, you don't want to miss the lesson. And we start talking about what do you do in the season of waiting? You rest. That rest is remember, expect, submit, and trust. And we talked about remember last week and not forgetting to remember, because remembering will strengthen you spiritually and emotionally. When I sit back and I think about that Christmas, I remember where God has brought us from. I'm so glad I ain't got to eat beans and hot dogs this Christmas. I'm so glad that we got real decorations on the tree. I'm so glad we got gifts under it and enough gifts to bless other people. When you remember, it causes an expectation of God to do it again. Oh, y'all don't have no. See, we were singing that song, Believe. I was ready to jump out of my skin. They sang it this morning. I didn't think I was going to make it. Are you believing God for anything? I don't know about you, but I got some things that I'm believing him for. And when I remember, it automatically triggers the expectation. Now I start looking for it. I keep talking about this recruiting process with my son. It's so funny. It's just going all crazy. This last few weeks, we're getting emails and all this other stuff. And it's all great. And then I'm sitting there, we believe for it in the service. We got two more offers. Happened, 8 o'clock this morning. When you're believing for something, it's an expectation that comes up in you. And it's like, oh God, I'm excited now to see what you're gonna do. See, in my waiting at first, it was on my nerves. I was ready for it to be over. But now I see the finish line. I see him working it out on my behalf. I said, my, because this ain't got nothing to do with him. It's all about me. I tell them all the time. They got their little awards and all that. Bring it here. This ain't about you. We put the work in. I want every honor award, every award that school get. I want it and bring it to me on my desk. And you're not taking it with you when you go. All these accolades staying right here. Okay, no, move on, Pastor. Remember. Causes expectation. And when you expect, you submit to his will. And you learn to trust him. So I want to go to Luke 2. It's the Christmas story, and the angel is talking. And it's amazing. In Luke 2:10, the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good news," or some scripture says, good tidings, "of great joy, which will be for all the people. For today in the city of David, there has been born for you a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." He is the gift of joy. Now, the joy is the inner attitude of rejoicing in one's salvation, regardless of outward circumstances. One of the fruits of a right relationship with God. I can tell if you're in right relationship with God if you got joy. I'm going to tell you right now, coming up in church, there was a lot of people, especially the ushers, that did not have a right relationship with God. Them ushers was the meanest people I've ever seen in my life. They was never happy about nothing. They didn't even smile and greet you when you came in the door. Just mean and surly. It was something wrong with their relationship with God. Because joy is a signal of right relationship. Ask somebody, you got your joy? You got your joy? No, ask somebody else. Don't be scared. You got a mask on. Pull it up. You got your joy? You got your joy? Because if you say you are of him, then there should be a light that is in you that should manifest as the joy of the Lord. I walk around, I sing stuff like this. Still got joy. Still got joy. After all the things I've been through, I still got joy. Still got joy. Still got joy. After all the things I've been through, I still got joy. I sing myself happy. But what I'm finding in Christmas present is that there are many people, even some Christians, that have lost their joy. It's amazing. Y'all watch Hallmark movies? Yes, you do. You ain't got to tell me. Hallmark movies. You watch the Christmas movie. They all got the same plot with the same 12 actors. It's not going to end no different. The problem is going to be solved in the end. Santa Claus is going to come save the day. But I was watching one particular movie, and they went to go see Santa Claus. And it's amazing how when we're younger, we ask for things. Oh, I want this top doll, I want this toy, I want this PS5, I want Roblox, or Bowblox or something, I don't know. I want a gamer chair, I want gaming headsets, I want all of these things. But when you grow up, you start asking, well, Lord, I just want peace. Can I just get a sound mind for Christmas? Can I know, Lord, can you just help these knucklehead kids? We start asking for things that are not superficial or tangible. And in this movie, the little kids were telling Santa what they want, and then Santa asked the mother, well, what would you like for Christmas? She said, Santa, I just want to be happy. And you know, this guy came from the back and they locked eyes. And then next thing you know, he swept her off and married her and they live in Switzerland and he's a multimillionaire. I got issues, I'm so petty. But how many times have you asked just to be happy? But if you're asking to be happy, that's your problem. Because there is a difference between joy and happiness. A lot of times in our relationships, even in marriages or courtships or whatever, one of the main things that we never talk about that the real issue is you're expecting them to make you happy. And there is no way one person can fulfill your happiness. Honey, let me tell you, this joy that I have, I take this joy and go to the mall, I'm in bliss. Nobody even gotta be with me. I'm happy in Jesus alone. I don't depend on him for my happiness. He makes me happy. But because there is not a demand on him to be God in my life, I find that I am fulfilled in what God has given me and the gift of joy. I'm preaching good. I'm preaching better than some of y'all saying amen, I tell you that. Happiness. I'm with you, Rhonda. I got you right here. We won't keep going. Let's look at the difference where you can know if you're happy or you got joy. Happiness is external. It is caused by the things on the outside. Joy is internal. It comes up and spills out. Happiness is dependent on your circumstance. I don't even know how you live like that. Circumstance changes without you having anything to do with it. And if it's going to rely on something that is constant changing, how can you ever be in a conscious state of happy? Joy is independent of circumstances. It does not matter what is going on. This joy that I have, the world didn't give it to me, and the world can't take it away. What's happening on the outside cannot affect what's going on in the inside, and it's too costly for me to let you take it. I give away a lot of stuff, but there's some pieces in my closet I ain't never giving away. It cost me something. Happiness is the emotional response. And we learned earlier this year, you can't be led by your emotions. Joy is an act of the will. You have to decide that you are going to receive the gift of joy and all the benefits that come with it. And every time something comes up to challenge it, you have to stay in front and say, oh, you can't take my joy. You have all this. You can have this world, but you can't have my joy. Happiness is having what you want. Joy is wanting what you have. It changes everything. Happiness is the effect, but joy should be the cause. Happiness can be the result, but joy must be the foundation. Happiness is inconsistent. Sometimes you feel like a nut, sometimes you don't. Almond joy's got nuts, mounds don't. Because, you know, I'm an interesting individual. Because what made me happy 3 days ago may not make me happy right now. I tell people all the time, let me evolve. Stop putting me in a box. I used to like this, and I don't like that no more. Why? Just because I don't like it. I'm in my feelings. It's inconsistent. But joy is consistent. Happiness is a temporary state of being. Joy is eternal. You got your joy? I got my joy. You're going to have to start walking around and you're going to have to start declaring to yourself, I got my joy. I got my joy. Do a joy check. You got your joy. You got your joy. I got my joy. I got my. Carl, you remember that? You got your joy. You got your. It's a joy check. Because in the grand scheme of things, no matter what's happened to you, it's nothing compared to what happened to him on that cross. And for that, I am forever grateful. How do I get this joy, Pastor? When you surrender. You surrender your life to Jesus and discover the gift of true joy. And I don't mean confess with your mouth and believe in your heart, because I know that's, you know, you're going to be said, no, it's got to be more than that. You have to surrender. It can't be your will in any area of your life. You have to give it all to him. Not some parts. We're real good at compartmentalizing God. Well, God, you can work on this and you can work on this, but I got this over here. You can work on my kids, but I got my husband. Your kids are probably where they are because of your husband. You should just give it all to him. Well, I got my job. You don't have to worry about that. Don't lead me in that area. I got this. I just need you to work out this financial situation. Your job is probably tied to your finances. To receive the true gift of joy that was given for you, you gotta surrender. Even Jesus in the garden, he said, let this cup pass from me. I just don't want to do this. I don't want to die. It's going to be horrible. I already know what it's going to be. And then he took a pause and he said something like this. But nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. How many neverthelesses do you have in your life? So many processes this year. There's things that I want, but everything that I ask him for, I always end with, but nevertheless, not my will, but your will. See, when you understand the gift of joy, it's like when I was younger, no matter how many gifts under the tree, and it was a whole lot of gifts under the tree, I couldn't wait to get to my grandmother's house because my grandmother had an envelope with my name on it in the tree. I tell the story every Christmas, so if you're tired of hearing it, just know you're gonna get it every Christmas. And it didn't even matter what was in the envelope. And we could never tell what was in the envelope. My aunts and them still trying to figure out how much money was in that envelope. We still don't tell. She long and gone. It was the fact that no matter what happened, we didn't think about how she had to put what was in the envelope, what the economy was like, if she had it, if she didn't have it. I knew for a fact that when I walked in her house, there was going to be an envelope in that tree with my name on it. When you have joy, there's always something in his presence with your name. That's why I don't have to fear or I don't have to be anxious, because he's always got something just for me. It's got my name on it. Joy has your name on it. And now I'm ending my Hallmark movie with Christmas Future. Y'all like how I did that? Christmas past, Christmas present, Christmas future. The Bible says, be joyful always. And God did not stutter. Always means always. Well, Pastor, you don't know what happened. I got this happening. I understand what you have happening, but joy is not based on the external. Joy is based on the internal, and I should always be joyful. Even when it don't go my way, when it don't look like, when I'm at loss, whatever it is going on the outside, it has nothing to do with the gift that I have been given on the inside. Do you have joy? Finding joy in the waiting means being at peace with where God has me while I wait. Finding joy means that whatever state I find myself in, I can be content. Do you know God can change anything at any moment in your life? And the fact that he doesn't usually means he's working out something in you. But oh, what a gracious God that would correct and fix the things that is wrong with me, so when I stand before him, I will be without spot or blemish. I don't know about you today, but I got my joy. And I don't want you to leave here without yours. So if you're sitting here today and you need a little more joy, you need a little more. Pastor, I hear what you're saying, but I've been struggling in the joy department. I just want you to stand to your feet. I'm going to pray for you right where you are. Don't worry about who's sitting next to you. It's a single file line to heaven. I just need a little. It's the season. Let me tell you, there's a season. There's also a Christmas spirit that comes with this season. It's a season of, it's a spirit of depression and oppression and heaviness. It's this heaviness that comes to try to steal your joy. But the gift had your name on it. It is for you. If you're at home and you need more joy, go ahead and type in the comments, need more joy. Stand with us. I need more joy. I hear what you're saying, Pastor, but I need more joy. I need to understand that it's not about outward circumstances, but it is the gift that I was given that is within. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for all those that are standing and those that are not, that should be. We thank you for increasing their joy. And not only increasing their joy, but increasing their awareness that they have it and what it costs for them to have. Let them not let the downers of the season cause them to lose their joy. That happiness should be a byproduct. It should not be a source. And that our true joy is found in you. We are be careful to give your name all the honor and all the glory and all the praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Come on and give the Lord a praise. You may be seated.